We can stop doing
right.
Welcome to Decent Life. I'm Lou Pulifido. The call-in number is 212-245-7273. 212-245-7273. The guidelines for calling in are is to lower the volume on your computer or TV because we don't want to have feedback while we're talking. Also, listen to your phone and not please do not watch the show because we're on an 8-second delay, which means I'll be trying to talk to you, and before you know it, I'll be hanging up and you'll be calling back. And if you like, you can give your first name and location where you're calling from. And today, we're continuing our series on candidates for New York City Council. And with me today is Pierre Gooding, who is a candidate for the Reform Party for District 9.
Yes.
Pierre, welcome.
Thank you, Lou, for having me.
Hey, it's a pleasure. Because, you know, I like to all the ideas coming in through all of them. And can you just, I'm not sure how many viewers are familiar with you, so can you tell us a little bit about yourself?
Sure. My name is Pierre Gooding. I'm running for City Council in District 9, Harlem. That encompasses 110th to 155th in St. Nicholas to Park, roughly. I was born in the Grand Projects on 125th in the 80s, and when I was born, there was a crack epidemic. My mom chose to leave the district because my zone school wasn't doing well, which was unfortunate that she had to make that decision. I came back to teach 6th and 8th grade English as a second language in Washington Heights at IS-143 Eleanor Roosevelt Junior High, and during that time I got to see some of the inequities that were going on in our community. Our classrooms didn't have air conditioners, and my zone school was still doing poorly. 10 years later, I had the opportunity to work in the ed space as legal counsel, and my zone school was ranked 1984th on School Digger, and my school that I had worked in still didn't have air conditioners. So we fought for 10 years. There's just been an initiative where every classroom in New York City will have air conditioners, but mm-hmm. that's a start. We need to make sure that we have data-driven instruction. As an educator, these are things that I care about. We need to make sure that we bring down the 13% unemployment rate in Harlem. We need to make sure that people have a place to live, and it's not just lip service. If we know the issues, then we have to have policies to address them and to make sure that we look out for our longtime community members that are currently having to leave the district because they can't find
So are you saying that in Harlem the unemployment rate is much higher than theirs?
It's three times the city average, three times the national average, and this has been persistent even as the city average has gone up and down over the years. Our a double-digit unemployment rate has stayed stagnant, and that's the effective unemployment rate. If you actually look at folks who are either working part-time or have stopped looking for unemployment or jobs. Bernie Sanders has the level at about 50%. I think it's probably about 30-40% in Harlem, but you're talking about persistent unemployment that requires policy at a city council level to address.
Okay, so what do you think are the particulars in that's holding the unemployment so high in that neighborhood?
Absolutely. Well, it's multifaceted. One, we know that our schools aren't producing the types of academic progress that we need. When we have schools that have been stagnant in terms of educational progress and we have other schools right across the street that are doing well, there has to be communication. We have to share that information. Right now we're fighting a false war between charter schools and traditional schools, and it's exactly that. All schools in New York City that I'm referring to are public, and so if it's a charter school that's doing well, we need to get that information to our traditional schools and vice versa. There's no reason that any child in Harlem shouldn't have the best of the best in terms of education, and then in terms of housing. If you are struggling to find an apartment, and these rates have gone up double, triple the rent prices, well, you're going to have a very hard time in terms of stability. And if you have to move around constantly, this affects your ability to have gainful employment.
Right.
So these things are all related.
Intertwined together.
Yeah, and in terms of the 13% unemployment rate, we need to say as policy leaders, okay, small business, we appreciate what you're doing for our community. We're going to support you. We will give you a tax break. Well, we want you to hire our longtime residents that have given 10 and 20 years of sweat equity.
So you're looking to put some type of laws in place to try to get more employment up there.
Exactly. And then holding individuals accountable and organizations accountable for the laws and rules that are on the books right now. Mm-hmm. We had a situation a couple of years ago where there was an exposure, Cesaria Podkul, at ProPublica, now at the Wall Street Journal, exposed situation where 50,000 units were not registered to be rent regulated, although they were getting the tax breaks for 421A. So it's about accountability.
So they were warehousing these apartments.
Exactly. So when you see issues, first you have to be there. You have to know that these issues exist, but then you have to tackle them aggressively when they come up so that you can represent your community members. And that's what we feel is missing right now.
Okay. So I think on your website you said that the average income in Harlem is $35,000?
Correct.
Is that correct? So how does that fit into the housing situation there? Because, you know, $35,000, it's really hard.
It's very hard.
I mean, I don't know, unless you're in the street.
it's
hard to for the family income of $35,000.
It's extremely difficult, and this is sort of the issue when I'm looking at housing policies where the median income is set at $60,000. Well, those programs, as much as they're advocated as being ones that put affordable units on the market, they're not hitting Harlemites. So we're effectively priced out of the very programs that are dedicated to making sure that New Yorkers can find mm-hmm. a place to live. So all of those programs have to be recalibrated to take into account our community, our constituents. And when we have rezoning or zoning and redevelopment of 80-20, where one out of every five units are supposedly affordable, that's not enough. And so we have to have leaders in elected office, outside elected office, who are sitting at the table representing our constituents, saying, no, it's not enough. I was really proud of Community Board 11 mm-hmm. That said, you know what? No to this redevelopment until we get 100% affordable housing, hospitals, the things that we need to really service.
So let's just go back for a definition. What is your definition of affordable housing?
Affordable housing for me would be a situation where an individual would pay anywhere in a neighborhood from $600 to $1,500. Now, those are artificial numbers, and it's based on who the individual is or the family is and what the situation is. But when I see circumstances, again, where the lot is for a median income of $60,000, it's just not going to it's just not going to help our community members. And so for apartments that are slightly higher priced, that's okay, but there has to be a real stock of apartments to choose from.
Yeah. So with the real estate industry being so powerful here, and you go, and if when you win the city council, how would you get other city council members who are in, you know, real estate, Buzz sure. parking and stuff? How would you approach, you know, trying to get the ball rolling on this, so with laws or whatever?
I think the numbers are there. There are enough affected communities where, if the tax packages for small businesses to hire individuals in any community that has double to triple the unemployment rate of New York City's average, I actually think the numbers are there for other city council persons to say, this is in our interest to pass this tax package. We know we have wealthy landlords that are supporting us, but this actually is not affecting them
right.
that much. If the policy is just to make sure that our folks have jobs, well, then they're going to be able to afford some of these higher priced units.
Right.
But step one is making sure that they have a job, and as the community changes, that our lifelong community members are just invested in that process.
Right.
But I do not think this is a war between lifelong community members and the real estate industry. I think that there has to be a marriage and a partnership, and we have to work together to be smart and bring
I think there's a war building up for, I think a lot of, I'm not sure in the city council, but a lot of Democrats saying that we need to repeal the Erstat law.
Well,
what do you think about that, and, you know, home rule for the city instead of the state?
Yeah, I think that any time the city can have control over the things that are going on in the city space, it's a good mm-hmm. thing. I actually advocated for mayoral control education-wise, as opposed to going back to the Board of Education. So I do think there's a need for our city to have control over different initiatives and different measures, as opposed to looking outside, looking to the state. And let's bring it back to the MTA.
Okay.
What's going on right now with our mayor and our governor both disclaiming responsibility, I think we've got to step up and
yeah, it's got to be everybody take responsibility for. So where has, because you know, you're running against incumbent Bill Perkins, so where has he stopped taking responsibility for? Why are you saying, you know, Bill, you're not doing a good job, and so on? What's the difference between you and Bill?
Sure. I mean, the issue that I have right now is multifaceted, but it starts in the fact that we have had zero sponsored bills since the incumbent came into office. And so I do not want to say that, oh, it's only been 7 months. No, 7 months is a long time for a community that's really struggling to hold on. My aunt and relatives are moving to the south because it's become unlivable in terms of apartment rates and apartment prices. These are issues that have to be dealt with immediately. We can't wait 4 years or 8 years until our incumbent retires, if that's what he chooses to do.
So he's just sitting on his hands.
I say that a lot more can and should be done right now in our community. And when you have a situation where the city council income gets jacked up, and then you have folks come down from state senate or assemblies to start running for office, we really just have to take a hard look at individuals and see who's
how
best.
Is that? Because in some districts that were on the show, they were talking about policing, the police and the community and their relationships. How are things up in your district with the police and
sure.
So on?
I will say this. The NYPD within Central Harlem, to my knowledge, has been doing a fairly good job at making sure that the community is safe and also that there's community involvement and that there is a partnership between the police officers and our community members. So I do want to give a shout out where a shout out is due. Now, is there always more work to do? We had a community forum last year where individuals said the number one issue is not that there is a stop and frisk problem. The number one issue is that on a daily basis, we need our police officers to work with us and tell us what's going on in a soft skill or in a soft capacity. What's going on a day-to-day basis so that we can work together. On multiple grounds, I'm against stopping this. As a libertarian, I believe it's wrong legally and constitutionally, but morally, and more importantly, I believe that it's wrong and it disproportionately. That is it negatively impacts my community, and I feel, and I'm sure if you talk to our members, they will tell you the same thing. It's not a good situation. It never has been, and it's not right for Harlem.
And how about the quality of life issues? I think that the mayor has slacking off on stuff, but I think some people are saying, you know what, you still need it in the subways because that's where you catch a lot of criminals. Do you think that's true? You think we should be lax with these quality of life issues, or should we take a different stance, or just certain instances?
No, I think quality of life is very important, but individual liberties are of the utmost importance, and we cannot get into a situation where we say, for the safety of our neighborhood, we're going to discard civil liberties. I will never advocate for that. It's not right, and there are ways to make sure. Harlem, in most respects, is a very safe space, and it's a safe space because of the community members who are actively watching and making sure that nothing bad is happening and planting trees outside of their apartments. So that's not the issue. The issue is making sure that when we see something going on, that we respond immediately. Okay. And even more than that, that we preemptively go in front of these challenges. If we know that there are dangerous neighborhoods, well, we must.
Right. Being proactive in communication is the key
to
making sure everything is.
Lou, you already
fine.
Know. Exactly.
Yeah. Well, you know. Well, let's go back to education, because you're saying that education is important.
Absolutely.
So, with the UFT.
Yes.
So, do you think that there needs to be adjustments in UFT? Sure. Because, you know, you hear stories about these rubber rooms with teachers. Are they giving us good teachers to UFT. I mean, to say, I don't know what the whole process is, but part of children to learn, you need good teachers who, you know, interact with their students and so on. So what do you think about the UFT?
Well, I met with the UFT and I said, look, I know as a charter school advocate, I can't be your guy, but after this is over, we're going to work together because we're going to increase teacher salaries. We're going to do the things that we know we have to do to get quality schools all across the city. There has to be a partnership. Nothing gets done in New York City in isolation.
Right.
And so working with the UFT will be a pleasure because I was once a UFT member as a teacher at ICE 143, and I understand what they're trying to do. They're trying to make sure, everyone is trying to make sure that we have quality schools in New York City, but it's about how do we efficiently and effectively get there.
And take on the hard issues.
Take on the hard issues.
Especially within the union. I love unions, but sometimes they have ridiculous rules. Like the rubber room.
Well, the rubber room. So the rubber room 10 years ago was an instance, some would say that it still exists in some capacity, whether it's called the rubber room or not. But the issue is, are we protecting those who are the most dangerous individuals as opposed to getting them out and making sure that those dollars go to real effective teachers who can push our students?
Okay.
I don't think the UFT or anybody else is for a model where they are protecting the worst of the worst. But the rules in place get to a point where it takes years to get people out of their positions. We want to work with the UFT, the Board of Education, and the de Blasio administration to make sure that we change those rules to make sure people can leave when they have to and we can bring the folks in that we need to
bring. So you said that you're in favor of charter schools.
Yes.
Versus public schools. Is there, or you want to bring the system, what's in it within a charter school, into the public schools?
It's not first, and that's what I want to absolutely make sure. I'm in favor of charter schools in Harlem because they're doing well, and the parents have already spoken. The parents are sending their kids to success academies because they are getting the results that they need in terms of performance. Any metric that you want to sort of look at, the kids are learning. And so I want to make sure that every school in my district is doing as well as the Success Academies. That's what it's about. It's not a competition. This is about learning. Charter schools were set up so that we could learn about what works. If they're working, then let's use the information and bring it
system wide. So what's your thoughts on like private schools or religious schools like the Catholic schools, the Catholic grammar schools, high schools, and so on like that. What's your take? Is this all into one bucket as everybody working together?
Well, I think we have to be careful. In New York City, what I am talking about are public schools, public traditional and public charter, where the dollars flow with the student.
Okay.
In terms of traditional private schools, where you might have a double bottom line in terms of profit versus student achievement, that's a whole different category of education that I'm frankly just not talking about.
Okay.
This is about public schools where people say, well, charter schools have a lottery and you're getting invested parents to go. And so, okay, let's not scrap the entire system because of a processorial issue. Let's fix the problem.
Because you're all getting better students in that lottery, aren't you?
So, Lou, what we could do, and this is where we have to be creative. Okay. This is not an either-or situation, right? What we could do is have a common pool, and every student would go to school X, Y, or Z, and whether it was traditional public, traditional charter, and that would be the end of the story, right? So this is not about solutions. We can get to the solutions. A lot of the conversation and discourse is outside of actually what's best for the kid. And that's
the number one thing. What's the best for the child and to make sure they put in into a great environment to learn. So what do you think is the overall key to success for charter schools that you would want to get into public schools?
It's an environment. An environment. When I walked into a Success Academy, and I saw sort of just the level of discourse. I heard the level of discourse that was going on. I was taken aback because I said, this is something that I have not seen in a lot of schools in New York City, and I don't care what type of school it is. And so it's an investment from start to finish, where you have parents involved, where you have after-school programs, mm-hmm. where you make sure that the kids are learning, and not just through data-driven instruction. It's an important metric, but you're making sure the kids are learning because you get that feedback from right. them and from their parents. And so it's a process. It's learning what works. We're seeing all-time high measures come back from Success Academy in other charter schools and other schools in New York City that aren't charters. So let's learn from them.
Exactly. I think that sounds great. What's interesting when you mentioned the parents, I mean, are there community involvement going on to make parents to feel comfortable with? Because I know that sometimes the disconnect is because the child is just home and on their own. So are there programs in place or considering to help parents, whether the mother, father, or together, or maybe even the grandparents, to help the child in school and make a better environment at home?
Well, that's where we want to bring this to the next level. That is part of what we want to do, is say, okay, for a parent that is trying so hard to make sure that their kid is doing well, well, let's make sure that the parent can follow along at a certain level. The homework becomes very intense. So let's make sure that the parents can do the work as well so they can teach their son or daughter. Let's pair this with training and retraining programs for our adults so that they have a stable job and so that they can provide for their son or daughter on the level they need to so that the kid can.
And just one more question on education is, how's the infrastructure up there with those schools?
Well, look, there's always a sort of space concern. This is New York City. So you're always going to look at what makes the most sense. There's a lot of co-locations with Success Academy and other charter schools that traditional schools, the IS-143 in Washington Heights, we're co-loaded with Wheels. So there's always going to be space concerns, but we have to make sure that we have the space for our schools as opposed to anything else. This is the most important thing we can do.
Okay.
If we don't have quality schools.
Okay, I'm going to be a little more out. How about the small business owners? And I mean, in a lot of districts, you know, small businesses are getting displaced.
Yes.
You know, and I know that Target and you know, that whole thing is not in your district, but you know,
Whole Foods is, and they came in on the 21st. So,
all right.
Yeah, and we met with them. We met with the representatives at Whole Foods to ask, who are you hiring? Are you hiring our residents, or are you hiring from outside of our district? They showed us their numbers. They asked us to ask the community members to come out and apply so that they can hire more aggressively. But it has to be that conversation, because if the answer had been no, well, then why not? And let's figure that out. So, but in terms of small businesses, as a former small business owner, small businesses are hyper important to me, and I think. One, we have to make sure you don't have to go through 7 or 8 entities just to open up a small business in New York City. That is a running joke that has permeated
a lot of red tape
for a long time. And New York City is a place where you should be able to work on that.
So how are we going to keep the small business owner in the neighborhoods? Not just here, but you know, it's a tough question for all districts.
No, yeah, absolutely. So we look at the tax structure a little bit, and if we're actually serious about it, that's where we can put them back at
the tax structure.
Yeah, at a level playing field. Because if you, unfortunately, Starbucks, you're dealing with a $1 billion industry, and if you're a small coffee shop owner, we got to make sure that you've got a chance to compete.
Exactly. All right, so you know what? We're coming up. You know, I got a few minutes left, and I want to make sure because that I covered everything that's near and dear to you. So, is there anything that I missed that you want to discuss?
Well, I just want to say to our New York City voters, this is an incredibly important election coming up. The general election on November 7th will determine where Harlem and New York City goes for the next 4 years and beyond. So, please go out. Make an informed choice. Read about your city council and mayoral candidates, and then make an informed choice because it's very important for the future of Harlem. And I appreciate your time.
Sure. Thank you.
Well, thank you. You're wrapping up the show a little bit too early, but
no, we got some minutes left. We got some time left. Well, look, we're here, so call in, please.
Yeah, it's 212-245-7273. I think that everybody's just interested in your platform and what you really want to do.
Absolutely.
And I think my concern is. That I have is I've seen a lot. I mean, I've been in the city for over 60 years, right? I'm a native New Yorker. I saw the real estate, but for somehow always getting derailed. And I think that you need, and other city council members must take a hard line against real estate. And they have to understand that business is great now, but when you have no middle class left in the city and you, nobody can save any money, you're basically hurting New York City.
Exactly.
And we need to, and so hopefully you could get elected when you get in office to get everybody to coalition to do something instead of looking the other way. Because even where I live in the Upper East Side, it's, you know, people can't live. If I was under rent stabilization,
exactly,
I would have been long out of the Upper East Side.
And I think there's a very important point, which is we're dealing with sort of an international market where apartments are being bought 20, 30-year investment pieces. So your long-term Harlem constituent is now having to battle against these real estate increases, not just because Harlem has become a hotspot and everyone's moving there, but also because internationally it's becoming an investment opportunity.
Yes.
And so we have to, as a community, counteract that, make sure that our folks have a place to live. It is not right to kick out the folks who have put decades of sweat equity into their community.
So do you think there needs to be aggressive taxing on, per se, investment properties, per se? Try to get, somehow to stop the speculation? Is there a way to do that?
It is one approach. I don't want to fall into a pattern of saying, tax increases to solve every problem. When we take a look at it, if we were even to buy some of these apartments ourselves as a city and then allocate them that way, there are ways to make sure that our folks have housing. But we have to know what's going on in this space. Tax hikes for sort of speculation or in that realm, it's something to look at. But at the end of the day, there's many ways to make sure that New Yorkers have affordable housing, if that's what we want to do.
No, we could talk on and on. And you know what? I don't think people realize, as you're saying, go get out to vote. But Pierre is not in any primary. He's with the Reform Party, so which means he's going to be on the November ballot. So you could, in November, come out and vote for Pierre. But in the meantime, if your schedule permits, you always could come back again, and maybe we'll get on the, see if Bill Perkins is still here, maybe we get Bill on something, but you're more welcome to come back on.
Absolutely, and we would love the opportunity to discuss these issues with Mr. Perkins or anybody else, because we think that they are very, very important, and we think our message sort of speaks for itself.
And that's if he wins the primary.
Exactly. Look, you got to make it through the primary first.
That's right.
There are a lot of great challengers who have great things to say, and we will see.
And Pierre, thank you for coming on.
Lou.
All right.
And now the right timing.
That's the right timing now. And, with ideas that you have and the enthusiasm, we can stop the rain. And all you need is love. Thanks for watching.
Thank you. All right. Great stuff.